Good afternoon all. Today we have Dr. Dhara Patel with us. She is working as Associate Professor at Charotar University of Science and Technology, CharuSat, in Electronics and Communication Department. On behalf of Parul University, I welcome you, Dr. Dhara. Dr. Dhara has published a book chapter titled as CMOS Active Inductor and Its Application, in October 2019. She has published 4 papers in international journals and 2 papers in IEEE international conferences. She also published an article in Gujarat Times in New York in June 2010. Dr. Dhara has a good technical skill in analog RFIC design, antenna design, and digital system design. I welcome you, Dr. Dhara, and request you to deliver important information on analog perceptions of CMOS technology.
Hello. My
yes,
slide yes, is visible.
Yes.
Okay. So first of all, thank you very much, ma'am, for giving me this opportunity to deliver a webinar on the analog perceptions of the CMOS technology. So let's begin. So for today's webinar, the outline would be the perception of analog engineering, parameters of the CMOS device physics, MOSFET operation as a capacitor, resistor, and the inductor. What is the current progress of CMOS technology? And lastly, we'll see what available SPICE tools to work with this field. So very first is, why analog? In today's world, if we see everywhere, we just heard that digital, it has become very buzzing word. But behind that, what is analog? That should be very clear to us. So we know that our entire world is analog. Whatever we taste, whatever we smell, whatever we touch, that all in the analog form. What happens whenever our natural signal we want to process for the computational process, we are using the digital circuits. But today we have the totally reverse trend. So mostly the people are working with the digital, but not clear about the significance of the analog signal in that. So one famous analog guru, Samuel Wilkinson, said that anyone can count the number of ones and zeros as we deal in the digital circuit, but analog design requires an engineer to make the intelligent trade-offs to optimize the design. So as per this line, we can say that the analog is not that much easy compared to the digital, but it's not difficult. We can deal with the analog circuit if the fundamentals are very clear to us. The second, we can say that the analog design is like not the black or white as we represent in the digital system as ones and zeros, but the analog design is a shades of gray. That means we have very number of parameters to take care while designing the analog design. And the third is, like it is said that when we are more inclined to the analog circuit designing, then we have to behave like a cowboy. That means we have to look at we have to become a very creative, we have to become a very brave and the independent. And if we consider ourselves as an analog designer, as a cowboy, then the digital is the herd of animals. So what would be the analog IC applications? So whenever we are nowadays, we are using the IC, everywhere we are using the chip designing. So in that, 20% part of any VLSI chip is the analog part. Mainly we can say if we have any sensor interface, we have the data converters where we are taking the natural signal and then after we are proceeding using the different processors and the different computational method. Ultimately, we can say it is one part of the mixed signal VLSI. And last, if we just look at the application of the analog at the high frequency for the current 5G applications and all, they are at the high frequency. So in that also, we have one part as an analog, as a signal, input signal. Now, first, apart from the outline, I'll discuss other things that would be helpful for the students if they want to pursue in this particular field. So what is the required set of skills? If we want to become a very successful analog IC designer, then we have to have the semiconductor physics fundamentals, the control theory, network analysis, electronic design automation. It comes under the EDA tools, okay? Then the signals and the systems, and lastly, what is the our final, that is the fabrication technology. What are the, if we have designed the things very well, but if we are not aware about the fabrication technology that would be feasible or not, then it would not work at all. Now, if we look at the design approaches, then there are two design approaches. Design approach one, we can start from the quantum mechanics, we can move to the solid state physics, then we can come to the semiconductor device physics, we can model the device, then we can design the circuits. But again, it's extremely tedious and the time consuming. Second approach, what we can adopt, that we can consider the semiconductor device as a black box. We can define the behavior of whatever our expectation in terms of the voltage and current, and then we design. But for the second approach, what happens, it is extremely difficult. That means those are very experienced person in this particular field. They mainly start with this approach number two. Now, as we have, mostly we know that the VLSI design flow, the ASIC flow and all, the same we have the analog IC design flow. It starts with the idea and it comes with the product. By following the design steps, what we have, the layout step, what we have, the testing steps and all. But in a broader way, we can classify in the four terms. One is the electrical design. The second is a physical design, the anti-fabrication, and the last is the testing and the product development. So we can say at each and every segment, we need the engineers. But again, the question, being a student, question comes to the mind, which segment should I focus? Should I start with this design or what? So if we just look at the LinkedIn different company profiles, we have the main two types of opportunities under this analog IC design. One is the analog design engineers, or second is the custom layout. So if I am very good at this circuit designing, then I'll approach with that. I'll go with the analog design engineer. So analog design engineers have the role of that. They will see the specification and they will design that circuit. After that, if we'll just look at the second part of that, that is the custom layout. The custom layout means we have to look at the layout part. So in this market, if we just look at, we search about the job opportunities, and we have the analog design engineer and second is a custom layout. So according to our interest, we have to develop our skills. So as in the CMOS, we know that we have the MOSFET. So why and what? So again, it's very simple MOSFET definition. MOSFET is a four-terminal device where we have the gate, drain, source, and the body. But again, we have why it is too much used in current era. Because easier fabrication, as we are dealing with the glass and all. Overall, the better, it gives a better performance. It is the cost effective. And in that, continuous performance and enhancement is there. So I'm not talking about that. This is the current and latest technology the CMOS technology is using. But this is a very conceptual CMOS technology, very mature CMOS technology. And again, we can say that in the electronics, always we have the trade-offs. So if we have, we want to overcome the trade-offs in the CMOS, then we currently, the people are also using as a FinFET, the quantum physics and all. Okay. So this is all about the simple metal oxide semiconductor FET. Now I'm going to the how the what are the operation of that. So again, here we know that there are total four figures, A, B, C and D. The figure number A shows that is in the cutoff. So what do you mean by the cutoff? Again, MOSFET, it's nothing like one switch. If I'm considering this is my gate terminal, this is my source terminal, this is my drain, and the last at the bottom, that is my body part. Okay, so if I am applying the gate voltage as a zero, that means ultimately we want current to be flow from the drain to source. Okay, so there is no any path between these two terminals. So we can say the transistor is in off condition. In a better language, we can say the transistor is in a cutoff. Second way, if we are using this type of MOSFET, then it is useless. So what we have to do, we have to create a channel. We have to induce the channel. So in order to induce the channel, what we are doing, we are applying the gate voltage at this terminal. This is a control voltage. Ultimately, underneath this gate, we have the channel. So, and this channel is what it is currently, it is showing the constant potential throughout this channel. Okay, so whenever we have throughout this channel, we have the constant potential, then we can say that is in the linear mode. Or what we can do, linear characteristic, we can say if we are applying the VGS continuously and we just measure the drain current, then it is the it is exactly following the linear graph. Okay, now here, second, if we come from figure number B to the C, here what happens, we can say the channel formation is in a tapered form. It is not at all in a constant. So the question may come, why it is following that? So ultimately, this equation, whatever the channel, that is the charges, so whatever charge equation we have, that is the product of capacitance, the oxide capacitance and the potential difference. So earlier we have the constant potential in this, but now when we are increasing the gate potential, and earlier the drain voltage was very very small. Okay, but now we are increasing the VDS. So when we are increasing the VDS, what happens at this terminal, if we just use this equation, when the VDS, I am just talking about this equation at the drain terminal. So at the drain terminal, when I'll apply by VDS exactly equal to VGS minus threshold. So what this equation comes to? It comes to the zero. Zero, that means it is pinching to this point. Okay, same way, if we consider the counterpart, at this counterpart, we can say this is, it is like having the like a significant amount of charges over this, because at the length L equal to zero, we have the charge, that is the COX VGS minus threshold. So here we can say, because of the equation, only we are just moving along this channel. And as we are increasing the potential at the drain voltage, because of that, we are getting the tapering in this particular channel. Now, after and this particular operating region, we can say that is in the saturation. It is saturating. It will not go beyond that, whatever the drain current. See, always why we are fetching the drain current, because the MOSFET is it is one transconductance. When we apply the input voltage at the control voltage, it gives a current. That means it is a transconductor. Now, in that saturation, again, we have a subcategory. What is that? So, if I want to define the pinch off condition, then pinch off condition is when my VDS is exactly equal to, let's come again this equation, when the VDS is exactly equal to VGS minus threshold, that is, it is following the pinch off. But If I am applying this VDS higher than this voltage, come to the figure number D, then what will happen? Now, when we apply this VDS higher than this VGS minus threshold, what happens here? This channel V is earlier we had a pinch off, but now here the channel is getting modulated, and here the channel length modulation. Indeed, earlier the channel length was the L effective, but now if we just look at the channel, effective channel length is the reduced one. So why, how still we are getting, and how, why we are telling this is in a saturation? Because when we are just still increasing this drain voltage here, ultimately we are increasing the potential over here. When we'll increase the potential over here, this is our P-type body. So here what will happen? The depletion region is creating. You just compare the depletion region for this figure number C and D. Now, in this depletion region, we have very effective and very high electric field. So it again, see, the field concept would be always there. As per the name of the MOSFET is a metal oxide semiconductor. That means here the field, if we have the high electric field, then what will happen? It will give the electrostatic force. And because of that force, whatever charges in this particular effective length, they are feeling force and they are reaching to this. So if still we are increasing the VDS, we are getting the drain current. And again, we can say this is one condition. Ultimately, saturation definition we define with this pinch off, but above that we have the constant current is flowing. So this is very important concept, because of, I am repeating that, when we are increasing the drain voltage greater than the VGS minus threshold, here the depletion region is creating, it is becoming wider and wider. And because of this depletion region, we know the simple PN junction depletion region. Because of the depletion region, we have the high electric field. And here we have the higher potential. So because of the high electric field, electrostatic force is applying. And because of that force, the electrons are pushing from, electrons are getting pushed from this to this. And we are getting again the constant current in the saturation. Let's move on. So whatever we have discussed in that physics terms, if I want to plot my VI characteristic, then we can say this is the cutoff, this is the linear, and the saturation, it is this operating regions of the NMOS. Same way we can deal with the PMOS by considering all the things as in the complementary. Now, if we look at the more parameters, we have the body bias effect. In the digital, whenever we just use any transistor, only we are representing the transistor as a three terminal. One is a gate, one is a drain, and one is a source. But that is not always in the analog. In our analog, we always consider the MOSFET as a four terminal, because we need to check whether the body bias effect is present or not. So the body bias effect, let's see that it is also called as the back gate effect. So what do you mean by the back gate? You just look at this figure where my cursor is moving. This is our original gate where we can say this is my control voltage is applying. And exactly opposite to this, here we have the body part. So this is our main original gate, and this is back to this, that is called as the back gate. Now, when we just use the digital design, then always we just tie this body to the source. So what would be the potential difference between this? Always zero. But in analog, we have this, in many circuit, we have bodies connected to ground and the source is connected to the different potential. So in that context, my VSB is not zero. So if this is the case in analog, then how it would differ in performance? Let's see. It would change the threshold voltage. We know that whenever we just consider the operating region, in each operating region, we define the ID current equation. And in each ID current equation, we represent in terms of the threshold. So this is the main threshold equation where there is one term that is a VSB. VSB is the potential difference between the source and the, here we have the body. So if this VSB is equal to zero in digital, we have the threshold. But in as I discussed just, in analog, it is not always zero. So if I'm keeping some value over here, obviously my threshold voltage is getting changed. Okay. So this right hand side, this bottom graph shows how we are changing, how the body and the source potential is differing the threshold voltage. So as we are increasing this potential, that means if I'm connecting one battery at the source terminal and I'm continuously increasing that, then ultimately the threshold voltage of my device is getting decreasing. So ultimately we have the effect directly in the output drain current. Second is the channel length modulation. As we just discussed here, what happens, the length, whatever the length, that is getting modulating. So this concept is called as a channel length modulation, and this is very important when we just consider the very short MOS device and all. So what happens, because of this channel length modulation, we are getting drain current. But that drain current is not exactly constant. You just look at this right hand side figure. There are two lines. One is a solid and one is the dashed line. So when we have this pinch off, when we have the pinch off condition, the channel is pinching exactly at the drain terminal, then we can say the MOSFET is working as a constant current source. But because of this channel length modulation, what happens? Again, whatever the drain current is increasing, it becomes the function of my VDS. And in that way, I'm not getting constant, I'm getting again in this, this is ultimately my saturation portion. But in the saturation portion, again, my current is increasing. That is the adverse effect that we do not want, because we know that whenever we are using MOSFET, we want to use as a current source, but that current source we want as a constant. But because of this effect we are getting, this is not at all constant. So the body effect, the channel length modulation, all are creating the second order effects. Okay, so whenever we are just working with this very compact MOSFET, we have this all the second order effects, and because of this all the second order effects, we are not getting the ideal performance. So from that instance, our challenges are starting. Now next we will see the MOSFET working as a capacitor, resistor and the inductor. Now we know that when we are working with the in today's era, always we demand the reconfigurable, very compact devices. That so if I want to reduce my total chip area, then in my circuit, if I need the capacitor, resistor and the inductor, how should I keep that? Because ideally we know that whenever we use the capacitor, inductor and resistor, they are bulky, they are occupying more chip area. So that is one way how we can replace that with that very tiny MOSFET. So here the MOSFET as a capacitor. So this is one circuit where it can be used. There are other more applications as well. This is nothing but a voltage control oscillator. So in this voltage control oscillator, we need a capacitor and inductor. Here at the bottom part, there are two. This is the transistor M1 and M2 are connected back to back. But here the capacitor and inductor. Now I want to design this voltage control oscillator in a very compact form. So what should I do? I have to replace my capacitor with the MOS, and I have to replace the inductor with the MOS. So how? Let's see. So when it is very vector term is very common for the RF design. So how we can work with this? If we connect or we short the drain and source terminal of the MOS, then it will work as a varictor. So what, who can vary the capacitor? Variable capacitor, that means if the gate whatever voltage at this gate terminal, if we just plot the AC characteristic, if I want to check what capacitance it provides, so what we have to do, we have to do the AC analysis in the SPICE simulator. So in that we can say it provides the equivalent, depends on the W by L and the biasing, it provides the capacitance. Now second we'll see how it work as a resistor. Okay, so again, in chip designing, we are not using our typical resistor as we used to do in our basic electronics. Okay, so in that, what we can do, we can use a transistor in a triode region. Now, when we just deal with the analog IC design, we are replacing our word as a linear to the triode. That means what we mean by the triode is again this linear graph. But triode, that means it is having the three terminal. That means three electrodes. If the gate voltage, I am just changing my gate voltage, the current between the source terminal and gate terminal, it is getting changed. So because of this three role of these three terminals, we can say this is the triode. Now, what's the condition for the to operate the transistor in a triode? We know that we have to set the condition that VDS should be less than VGS minus threshold. So this is my linear graph. Now, the second, if we just go in a deeper of this, see, this is the again the linear, but that is not exactly linear. Okay, but if I want the exactly, I want to operate my transistor as a resistor, then I have to go in this deeper part. And this deeper part is nothing but it is one part of my triode. It is called as a deeper triode region. So what is the condition to operate the MOSFET in the deep triode? The condition is like that VDS should less than equal to twice of VGS minus threshold. Now, when we just maximize this graph, we have this. Now you can compare the graph for the right-hand side and the left-hand side. For the right-hand side, my VDS versus ID, this is more linear than this one. Okay, so more linear, that means it provides resistance in a better way. So nowadays, people are using the MOSFET. They are providing this condition to the circuit and they are using the MOSFET as a resistor. So this is one way how we can replace the resistor. And the third one is the MOSFET as an inductor. So this is called as the active inductor. Now, in the active inductor, earlier, we have seen the capacitor and resistor. They are also the active capacitor and active resistor. So in the inductor, what I want, if I want to behave my circuit as an inductor using the MOSFET, then I have to connect in particular pattern. So here, what one, I am just using few terminologies. Those are fundamentals in the analog. One is a positive transconductance and one is a negative transconductance. So this M1 transistor and this current, if I just look at the right side, right part of my circuit, that work as the negative transconductance, and the left part of my circuit work as the positive transconductance. So in this, we have in block diagram term, if the positive and negative transconductors are connected back to back, they create the gyrator circuit. That is one important concept. So when we are just connecting in this particular way, keeping in mind the transistor M1 and M2 should be in the saturation. So how I can check whether it work as an inductor or not? So for that, we can do the AC analysis in the SPICE simulator. And in the AC analysis, we can check the Bode plot. As I said, that is again one skill set required for this analog IC. So when we just go for that Bode plot in that, we can have such type of graph. So where we have to look at in the Bode plot, the magnitude plot and the phase plot. So again, this circuit is not like that. It is operating only, it is working only as an inductor. There are again some segments. If we are getting the magnitude of impedance, here we'll check the impedance. Okay. So impedance, when we'll check here, there is one sample Bode plot is mentioned over here. When it is constant, we can say for zero to this particular value of the frequency, this is Bode plot, that means omega is my frequency. During this frequency, it is working as a resistor. Okay, it is a constant one. After that, along with this magnitude, we can check the phase also. Okay, so this is zero. Now, when we are increasing this frequency span from next, then the frequency, the magnitude is increasing with the frequency. We know that what is the impedance of the inductor? 2 pi FL. Okay, so as the frequency is increasing, the magnitude is increasing. At the same time, this is not the only condition. This is the partial condition. We need to check what is the phase. The phase is a 90 degree. Then exactly it matches with the inductor electric parameters and the characteristic. So we can say during this span, it is working as an inductor. If we just move next, then the frequency is no more increasing. It is decreasing. So it is working in this frequency omega 0 to omega z. So if our operating frequency of my application is this, then I can use this circuit and I can operate in this as an inductor. So this is one inductor, MOSFET as an inductor. Now coming to the next, that is the NMOS characteristic and the second order effects we have seen. We have seen the MOSFET as an resistor, capacitor and the inductor. In that CMOS technology, we have the NMOS and PMOS both are connected. And this is called as a simple CMOS that is used for the digital applications. Now, when we in that, you know how we can design our different gates, the different digital system designs using this CMOS. So if I want to reduce the power of my chip, then for that, as I said, in the entire VLSI chip, there is 20% part of analog. There are some IO pin part, there is some RF part, and then there is one digital part. So if I want to reduce the total power consumption of my chip, then I have to play with the digital block. Okay. Then then if I want to increase the speed of my device, then I have to check the analog part. So for the higher speed component and all, the analog part is playing a vital role. Now we'll see what progress is present in today's CMOS technology. Before that, we'll see how we can categorize the CMOS technology. So in this, there is one submicron technology, deep submicron, and the ultra deep submicron technology. See here, this is the progress of the CMOS technology. How we can define that progress? We can check what is the length. The CMOS technology is defined with the length, like a channel length between the drain and source. Okay. So what is the length? If the length is greater than 0.35 micrometer, here I have defined in micro, we can convert into the nano, 350 nano. So if the length is greater than 0.35 micrometer, we can say we are using the submicron technology, submicron CMOS technology. But again, see, we know that every day the researchers are reducing and they are trying to occupying the more and more features in a single chip area. So they are reducing that channel length and they are moving from the submicron to the deeper submicron, where the here we have the length is 0.1 micro to the in between 0.1 micro to 0.35. But still, again, if we are just reducing the length, then it is called as ultra deep submicron technology. So it is, if the length is less than the point, less than or equal to 0.1 micrometer, then we can say it is the particular ultra deep submicron technology. So this is how we are just making our circuit very compact and compact. Now, if we just see, this is on the left hand side, I have tried to accommodate the Moore's law, how as per the we are passing with these years from 2007 to the current, how the semiconductor industries are trying to accommodate more transistors. So this is the span from 2007 to 20, and here the transistor density, million transistor per mm square. Million transistor per mm square. So if we just deal with the 45 nanometer CMOS technology, where we had 3.3 million transistor per mm square, to this 10 nanometer when the 100.8 million transistor per mm square. So we can consider how compact they are doing. So in that, if we just look at the current one, recently IBM has designed the 2 nanometer chip technology. That means in that 2 nanometer CMOS technology, we can say how small it is. So what are the advantages? The advantages is that the users can charge the device every 4 years, at the end of every 4 years. Then it is slashing the carbon footprint of the data center by saving the power. Obviously, we have the compact the device, the power consumption is less. Then it drastically speed up the laptop function. And the last, now we know that the detection, the sensors and all are very widely used. So it is contributing to the faster object detection. So this is the progress of current CMOS technology. Now, many a times we know that the nanotechnology, the silicon devices are the nanotechnology. That means they are very small in that size. So if, mainly we have used this 5 nanometer, 2 nanometer, but we have never seen how compact they are, because the manufacturing and all goes to the foundry. Okay, so in that foundry, very few are getting chance to visit that foundry. So we are not able to see with our naked eyes how small they are. But if we compare, here I have kept two images, the transistor for the 90 nanometer process. So in that 90 nanometer process, we have one foundry setup. Foundry setup, that means for the 90 nanometer, so for the 45 nanometer. So in that, if we just compare the size with that one virus, I have kept one virus, that is the influenza virus. So if we just measure the length, that is of 100 nanometer. And nowadays we are dealing with the 2 nanometer. This is the image of 50 nanometer. Okay, so we can compare how small they are. Now, this is already we have covered, but in that IC technology, again, it's not like always we have to deal with the CMOS. There are many more, because always we have that products. So bipolar, CMOS, if we are just combining these two, then we have the bi-CMOS. Then here the SOI, the SIGE, silicon germanic and gallium arsenide and all. But again, this is again, I'm repeating why CMOS, because here as we have just this is, it is dissipating very low power, high packaging density, and the scale down more easily. fully restored the logic levels, and here we can say it is approximately giving equal rise and the fall time. So this rise fall time, the restoring logic device, and all are like a very famous terms for the while designing the digital system. So as we have just discussed how the number of transistors are getting increasing, so we can say from the small signal integration SSI, currently we are using the giant scale integration, that is the GSI. So here, as the number of transistors are getting increasing, we have more and more integration. We have to scale that components, and this is how we are progressing slowly, slowly. Now, many times in that VLSI design, we can do some programming in the digital part, and we can contribute to the VLSI technology. But when it comes to the analog, the question comes to the mind, how we can design our analog design and how we can simulate. As I have just discussed that, in that job, in terms of the job opportunities, we can say we can work as analog design engineer, or we can work as a custom layout. Okay. So if in the analog designer, only we have to deal with the schematic, and we need to check the performance of that design before the layout. And in that custom layout, we have to go with that. We have to design the layout. Then we need to, we have to extract that parasitics. Then we have to check how the circuit would work in the real field. So here I have kept certain EDA tools for the IC design. They are totally free tools available. All these tools are, you have to install your Ubuntu design, Ubuntu OS, and you, or you can install that virtual machine, and you can run all this. In that, I'll see one by one how they are useful to us. First is the NGSpice. The NGSpice, the SPICE term is very, very well known, the simulation program for integrated circuit emphasis. So when I want to design any circuit, then I need such type of SPICE simulator where I can play with that that model parameters. So the NGSpice is used for the general purpose circuit simulation program for the nonlinear and the linear analysis. See, the nonlinear and linear analysis, there are again, when we just start to design any circuit, we need to check what is the performance of my signal, whether it linear or the nonlinear. Because as we are just moving with the from lower frequency to the higher frequency, our signal is not at all following the linear graph. It comes in the nonlinear. So we need to check whether the all these limitations are there or not. So in the NGSpice, we can perform both the linear as well as the nonlinear. Second, the magic tool. The magic tool is used for the layout editor, extraction, and the DRC tool. So these are the like from the starting with the specification to the layout. That is the entire flow. Okay. If you want to work in any of your project or in the summer internship and all, so you can design any circuit, you can implement in the NGSpice, and you can just do the layout. So we need to check what is the performance before the layout and after the layout. That is called as the pre-layout simulation and the post-layout simulation. So in that pre-layout simulation, what we do, we are considering whatever the connections in that circuit, they are having the zero delay. But in the real world, it is not like that. So the layout part is very significant. It is a must if we want to do a very like to the level work. The third one is that the open timer. The open timer, that is for the timing analysis. If we are designing any digital block, so always we just do the timing analysis. What's the delay? What are the glitches and all? So for that, we have one open timer tool, the eSIM. eSIM, that is, that is a SPICE simulator, but it covers the flow from the circuit design to the PCB. as we compare with the ngSpice, in the ngSpice that is only the circuit simulation where we can't do any PCB designing, but in the eSIM it covers the complex circuit design to the SPICE simulation and to the layout part. And the Q-flow, that is if it is a, it contains the tool chain like the EOSIS and the Greywolf for the complete RTL to the GDS flow. RTL, we just start with the digital, we just write the RTL, and final, the file that is ready to fabricate, that is a GDS file. So in the Q flow, you can cover this entire flow from RTL to the GDS. So this has certain EDA tools for the IC design. So before ending this, we'll see how the ngSpice is working. So I'm just opening my virtual machine. Okay, so if you have the Windows system, you can install the Oracle VirtualBox. And in that, you have to install the packages for each simulator as we have just discussed. So I have installed the Oracle VM VirtualBox and all the packages required for that. So now we are just taking how the ngSpice is working. So ultimately, the analog IC design, in that there are the like wider flavor of that circuit. But for that simplicity, I want to discuss how we can simply draw the CMOS inverter, as a CMOS inverter is quite familiar to all. So I'm just trying to design the CMOS inverter in the ngSpice, where the tool is ready with all the packages. So first, see the tools. Okay, it is already there. Let me make the another file. Spice. CT Spice. Now here, what we have to do, when we are just drawing that, when we are just trying to implement any analog IC design, the schematic is that. So here, first I'm just writing the schematic. I'm using the Vim editor. Okay, so this is the netlist. This is the exact way how the industry is working with the SPICE tools. So in this, the first is the netlist description. Okay, so this is, yeah. So netlist, what is the netlist? Netlist, that means in my circuit, how the all the nets are connected, that least of all the nets. So in that, in the CMOS inverter, I think the CMOS inverter is quite familiar to you. There are two transistors, one is the M1 and second is the M2. I have CMOS, that means one is the PMOS and one is the NMOS. Now in this, how the transistor M1, that is my PMOS, how it is connected. So these are the nets, out, in, VDD, VDD. So here it follows the drain, gate, source and bulk. What is the sequence of that? Drain, gate, source and bulk. That means the whatever that the drain is connected to out, the gate is connected to in, the body is connected to VDD, and my source is connected to VDD. Same way the M2, it is following the same, but it is the NMOS. Now the output capacitance is connected between the out node and the zero. Zero signifies my ground, And what's the value? The third value indicates the 10 femto, only 10 femto. The VDD, what is the VDD? VDD is connected, the node name is VDD, and what's the value? It is connected between the VDD and zero, and the value is the 2.5. And the input voltage, that is the into zero, my input voltage I have applying from zero to 2.5. Now, in this netlist, as we have discussed, M1 and M2 transistor, the drain, gate, source, and bulk, this is the PMOS, what two values are given. This is the W and this is the length. Now we have seen that the length signifies what technology you are dealing with. And this is the, whatever the length, length is between the my source to drain. So that is my length, and whatever the perpendicular distance, that is my width. So for this PMOS, this is my width, 0.375 micro, and the L is 0.25. So we can say that currently we are dealing with the here which technology? 250 nanometer CMOS technology. Okay, so same way here we have the W and L. And after this is my netlist. After this, what is the simulation command? For the simulation, we have to give few commands how my what responses I want. So I want the DC response, DC analysis, that means inverter, the output versus the input. For that, I need to vary my input voltage from 0 to 2.5 with the interval of 0.05. Okay, in all, no need to mention unit, it will take it automatically. Now, as we have mentioned here, the 0.25, that means the technology is 250 nanometer. Now, we have discussed that for each CMOS technology, we have certain foundry. And in that foundry, they have certain model parameters. So, model parameters, that means if I am keeping the length of my MOSFET as a 250 nanometer, then what would be the capacitance, what would be that junction capacitance, what would be the dielectric, what would be the threshold, all that device properties would be listed in the model files. So when we want to run that, along with this netlist, we have to give the model file, that is called as, this is my model file. Okay, what is the name? .lib TSMC. TSMC is the Taiwan Semiconductor at the China. Okay, so TSMC, this is my model file. So this model file consists of all the model parameters for this two transistor. So what is the netlist? Netlist consists of the list of nets. Okay, this is my list of nets, what component are connected, and the simulation command. And last is the what library you are dealing with. Okay, so this is we have added in that. Now we'll use that model file. So here I have kept all this ready. Okay, so this is a model file, you can see. See, the model file, here this model file having all that information, what is my TOX, what is my threshold, what is constant value K1, K2 and all. So this particular 250 nanometer model file, we are just pasting over here. Now, what we have to do, we have to use my ngSpice. So in that ngSpice, I'm just writing ngSpice. I have used a different name. Taste dot. Run. Set plot. So So this is nothing but my CMOS inverter characteristic. So this is how we can see, this is my input voltage and output. It is giving the exactly inverted graph. So this is how we can use the NGSPICE. We have seen only the DC characteristic. Along with that, we can check the transient analysis. We can check the AC analysis. We can check the delay. We can extract that component. Okay, so this is the first part. So after that, what we can do? This is called as a pre-layout simulation, where we have uploaded my model file for the active component transistors. Then I have simulated on that SPICE. This is my pre-layout simulation. We can measure the propagation delay and all. After that, you have to draw the layout. So for that layout, as we have just discussed, we have the magic layout tool. You have to draw starting from scratch, from the well, from that active part, the oxide and all. After that, you have to again run that, and you have to verify after the layout, whatever the propagation delay of the CMOS inverter, that is the post layout, and what are the results for the pre-layout. So this is how we can perform and how we can work in that analog IC design. Okay, so with this, I am just ending over here. So with this quote, I just want to end. The analog circuit design is like a chess. Just because you know how the pieces move doesn't mean you know how to play the game. Okay, so this is my contact information. If you have any query, then you can email me. Thank you.
I'm open for the question and answer if you have any. Yes, Dr. Dhara.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. If they have any questions, they will communicate with you or they will send you mail. And kindly give the answers through this mail. Okay?
Sure, ma'am. Sure.
Yeah.
So again, thank you for kindly listening me too.
As we end this informative webinar, I would like to thank you all for joining the webinar. In particular, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Dr. Dhara for sharing her expertise with us. I would also like to thank Parul University and PU Webinar Cell for giving me this opportunity. Thank you so much once again. Stay home, stay safe, and first get vaccinated. And take care, all of you. Have a good day. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, ma'am.